All right, I'm going to go ahead and get started with our presentation tonight. So welcome everyone to the Coalition's webinar, Building a Smart College List. Many of you submitted questions when you registered for the panel tonight, so we'll address many of those throughout the presentation. You may also use questions using the Q&A function of Zoom. So if there's time, we'll address those at the end. My name is Derek Chella. I'm the Director of Member Engagement here at the Coalition for College. The Coalition is more than 150 colleges and universities with a proven commitment to access, affordability, and student success. Together, we provide a set of tools called MyCoalition to help students learn about, prepare for, and apply to college. Our Coalition schools demonstrate their commitment by providing responsible financial aid and graduating students in a timely manner, including those who have been historically underrepresented in higher education. And we work proudly together as a membership to share best practices and move higher education forward toward greater access and equity. So MyCoalition is actually much more than an application, and it's designed to engage students as early as ninth grade by providing the locker, which is a free, unlimited storage space for documenting what you experience throughout high school and what you accomplish as well. It's mobile friendly and accepts any type of file. MyCoalition's collaboration space allows you to add your counselor, advisor, or other trusted mentor as a contact, and you can select files from your locker and share that with them for feedback. I want to highlight here the college list, as it is the Building a Smart College List panel tonight. So this is where you can actually opt in to receive information from our Coalition schools, as well as keep track of schools that you might be interested in applying to. And this can be easily shared through the collaboration space as well. This has both Coalition and non-Coalition member schools, so it's an excellent resource for building that smart college list that we'll be talking about tonight. MyCoalition also provides trusted college advice directly from our member schools through MyCoalition Counselor, which is on our website as well, as well as our virtual events like this one that allows you to engage directly with our member schools. So tapping into all that the Coalition has to offer is very easy and simple. Simply go to mycoalition.org and you can create an account. And of course, don't forget to follow us on Instagram. All right, so joining us today, we have a great group of admissions counselors who are going to share some of their knowledge, advice, and wisdom with you, as many of you all are thinking about creating or building a smart college list. So now I'll go ahead and let our admissions counselors introduce themselves, starting off with Sarah.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're having a great day. I'm really excited to be here. My name is Sarah Bombard. I'm a Senior Associate Director of Admissions at Lehigh University. I was told to tell you a fun fact about myself, which is that I love to bake. And my favorite thing to make is a Swiss meringue buttercream. So if you love cake and icing, me too, right there with you. I work at Lehigh University. We are a medium-sized private research institution in Eastern Pennsylvania in a city called Bethlehem. If you like to eat peeps, marshmallow peeps, those little candies, those are made in our city. So if you've had a peep or if you're expecting to have a peep in the next few weeks, you've had a taste of Bethlehem already. Hopefully you like it. Lehigh is a research institution, as I think I said, but we have four colleges, the College of Arts and Sciences, the Rawson College of Engineering, our College of Business, and a brand new College of Health offering majors in population health and a master in public health as well. So looking forward to answering some of your questions later tonight.
And hello, everybody. I'm Craig Broccoli. I'm the Associate Director of Admissions for Binghamton University, which is part of the State University of New York. Binghamton's a mid-sized public research university based in the upstate New York area. I'm based in New York City as a regional representative for Binghamton. And I've been working in admissions for about 10 years, but I get a lot of emails sent to Mr. Broccoli, which is my last name. It's spelled exactly like the vegetable. It sounds just like the vegetable. But a fun fact side of that, if you ever Google Craig Broccoli, you might get a photo of me, but you're often going to get a lot of photos of Daniel Craig, James Bond, partially because Barbara Broccoli produced the film and Daniel Craig, well, he's just a really good actor in there. So I'm okay with that. You Google Craig Broccoli, you get Daniel Craig.
Hi, everyone. I'm Lisa Cote. I'm the Assistant Director for In-State Recruitment at the University of South Carolina, which is a public flagship in the capital city of Columbia in the state of South Carolina. We have just over 27,000 students that hail from the state itself, as well as all 49 other states and across the globe. Fun fact about me, speaking about the globe, is that I was born in South Africa, so I was not a US citizen at the time of applying to colleges. So certainly can empathize with those of you that may be in those same shoes, but also have enjoyed my time working in the state of South Carolina since then. So thanks for being here tonight.
Hi, everyone. Last but not least, it's me. My name is Nick Igo. I represent Johns Hopkins University as Assistant Director of Admissions, overseeing domestic recruitment. I've been to all 50 states as a part of my job, which is absolutely crazy. But my fun fact that I chose to present is that before college, I was actually Peter Pan on Disney's On Ice. So cool random fun fact there for you. So now you got a little bit of kind of what we do behind the scenes, right? We're not just paper pushers for admissions. Johns Hopkins is the original research university in Baltimore, Maryland. We are the United States' first research institution. However, we're also known for the liberal arts. When you apply, you do not have to choose a particular major. You can sort that out once you arrive on campus. We have the School of Arts and Sciences and Engineering, but we're commonly known for biomedical engineering, public health, international relations and studies, and so on and so forth. Most importantly, I always want to share that we do not have loans as a part of our financial aid process. We meet 100% of demonstrated financial need through grants that you do not need to pay back to the institution, with our average grant being just over $50,000 per year. We really want the best students regardless of family income. So that's always important for me to share, but I'll turn it back over to our awesome hosts.
Awesome. Thank you all. It was very fun to learn those fun facts about all of you. So so tonight we actually received a large number of questions from all of you all who are on the panel or who are on the call tonight. So from students, families, counselors, advisors when you registered. So it's clear that there are actually a lot of the similar questions and similar concerns as we think about building a smart college list. So our presenters are here to help answer as many of those questions as possible over the next about 50 minutes. And we'll go ahead and dive right in. So the first question, let's make sure that the view is there. Great. All right. So the first question that I have, I'm going to throw over to Lisa. And one of our students asked, when should they start planning for college?
Great question. I also meant to mention that I was a high school counselor before this role, and so worked with students quite frequently with this exact same question. So really the time is now if you're asking it. If you're interested and you want to start the process, it's never too early. I think all of my colleagues on this call tonight would agree that if you are in the ninth grade and you're wondering about colleges, you can begin working on your academic record and keeping that locker with the Coalition for College. It's also never too late. So if you decide, talk to your school counselor because they can help you find the right schools at the right time. So kudos to you for being on here tonight.
Awesome. Thank you. And Craig, the next question I have, a student wanted to know, how can they explore or find out what they want to study in college?
Yeah, this is that ongoing quest and question. And I want to just preface this with, it's okay if you don't know, and it's okay if you keep changing your mind, because the truth behind the scenes is even when you end up at one of the many institutions you may see here or in the coalition, you might change your mind many more times. And that's kind of the point of college. But I do encourage students to start exploring a little bit now. Think about what do I might want to be in the future, and then you can't really figure out what that correlates to in terms of a degree, you can ask those type of people or your counselor, and then start looking at some schools that offer those degree paths and see what that really takes, right? You might want to be an engineer, but you realize you don't like math. Well, that's a question that you eventually will have to solve. It's a problem, but it's not at the end of the world. These are the conversations that, as just mentioned, if you're starting now, you'll start to figure this out pretty quickly over time.
Awesome, great, thank you. And Sarah, one student wanted to know, how important is it to choose a college that specializes in the area of study that you want to study?
Awesome question. Some people I think are born knowing what they want to be when they grow up. I did not know that being an admissions counselor was a job until about 2 weeks before I applied to be it, which is embarrassing because I worked in the admissions office as a student and I still thought all these people were just milling around doing presumably nothing. I don't know. Turns out we do a lot. But the idea that you would want to lock yourself into one thing, I think is okay. I will challenge you if you feel like, well, I'm going to be an engineer, so I want to go to a place that only has engineering, is fine. Think about the classes that you take at school now. What classes do you like? What classes do you not like? Would you never, ever, ever really want to take a history class again? Well, then maybe you want a university that offers a wide variety of things. Now, most colleges aren't going to offer just one major, but some really are focused in on one particular thing. So my personal advice is to go to a school big enough where you can take classes in a variety of different areas, even if it's just different flavors of things. Like, okay, well, maybe I don't just want to be a finance major. Maybe I'd also like to learn a little bit about accounting and a little bit about marketing. Okay, great, no problem. But if you are undecided, which I'm sure many of you are, and many of you know, the people that you know in your classes and even some of the grownups that you know were when they looked at colleges, if they even decided to go, it's fully okay to go to a college or university that offers a wide variety of majors and programs so that you can dabble and you can continue to explore the things that you like and maybe pursue them more deeply, and then maybe not do the things that you don't like as much. If you never want to take, you know, a language ever again, college is probably a place where you can find a college that will accommodate that. So I think it's okay. I think, but be maybe realistic with your expectations of what you want to get out of the college experience and where you want to end up, and have some, you know, give yourself some grace and allow some flexibility for changing your mind.
Awesome. So we also had a question that was submitted that was asking about how to find out what schools are best at. Can Nick, will you talk about, I guess, why would it matter to find a school that's the best at something, or why students should and how they should?
Yeah, I definitely can. First and foremost, I think it's a little bit of a loaded question, because I think the most obvious on the nose answer is that there are rankings out there that put institutions on lists based off of academic program. But you don't know how those lists are made, how they're quantified, how they're defined. And so it does need to be a balance of what is going to be a philosophical and academic match for you, along with what the program offers as an institution, right? Just because a school has the best computer science program on paper doesn't mean that you're actually going to connect with those faculty members, or that you're going to be able to stand out amongst your peers in that cohort. And so it's always important to contextualize your experiences there. Are they important, right? Is it important to go to the best institution with the best ranking by program? Yes and no, right? Because we've seen that students, regardless of where you go to college, will end up on the paths for the careers that you want, right? If you want to invest in the skill sets that you have, invest in the schools that are going to support you specifically, regardless of what a ranking is going to say, right? Is it matching with how far away from home you want to be, the financial situation and background that you're willing to invest in? Does a graduate degree, or is a graduate degree necessitated in order to move your career forward if that's your long-term goal? There's a lot of questions that relate to that specific program. So don't just make your list by that. It's an important starting place because you might find institutions that you've never heard of before. And so there is a pro there, but it's not the be all end all. And it's always important to contextualize yourself into those experiences and data points.
Thank you, Nick. So actually on this call, we have a lot of sophomores as well as a lot of juniors. And so one question that I'm gonna throw out to Lisa, since you are a high school counselor, is as a sophomore, what steps should they take to prepare themselves for college?
I think in the sophomore year, you still have the opportunity to research the required high school courses that colleges are looking for to make sure you're also on track and are having those conversations with your high school counselor. I know each state is a little bit different in what they require for high school graduation, but there's also a college entrance list for many colleges that you need to follow. For example, in the state of South Carolina, there's a prescribed list of colleges that all of the public institutions are looking for. So in your sophomore year, you can make sure that you're on track to meet those required courses while also exploring your interests through the following 2 years. And then I think now that college has so many opportunities on the websites that you can now peruse campus tours or chat with current students, you can start opening those doors without actually having to physically visit campus. There are a lot of resources at your fingertips on their websites. And most of the time you'll probably start at either the admissions website or the campus visitor website to find those resources so that you can start to see and feel and acknowledge what there is out there for you before you make the investment to visit a college campus. So that would be my advice.
Awesome. Thank you, Lisa. So this is actually a great time. I'm going to highlight a resource that we have on our Coalition website. So if you go to the resources tab there, there is actually a 9th and 10th grade college planning curriculum. So if you are a sophomore and you are thinking about some steps to take during your sophomore year, that's a really great place to start as well. Great. So the next question actually goes right in line with that. So what if I'm a junior? What are some things that I should be considering, or what are some steps that I should be taking? And Nick, would you be able to answer that?
Right down the barrel of the gun. Yes, I definitely can. It's a little bit more, right? Because more specialized anyway than what sophomores are doing, right? You have a little bit more exploratory time if you're a younger student, but juniors, right? You've probably already heard your junior year is going to be the last full academic year of grades that we as admissions officers receive as you apply to institutions. And that's regardless of whether you're applying through an early round, right? Early action, early decision, or regular decision, right? For the most part, you will not have a full year's worth of grades when you apply, unless you're applying to a rolling institution that is still admitting you after you graduate potentially out there. And so it is important to invest in that part of yourself. Start asking yourself the questions of, okay, which courses can I challenge myself and definitely succeed in? Which courses can I challenge myself and maybe have to put in a little bit more work to be successful? What are the courses that I'm not willing to challenge myself in at all, right? Start reflecting on how those are defining your academic interests. You know, we were talking about engineering interests and math and trying to reconcile that. If you're in your junior year and you're not excited about taking Calc AB or Calc BC, there's some signs that you should be paying attention to as you start cultivating those interests. Additionally, in your junior year, taking a step away from academics, it's also important to start honing your other skill sets. And so I'm going to qualify those as, you know, soft skills or employer valued skills. These are things that you'll carry with you regardless of your college application process. One of the best ways that you can start cultivating these skills, if you haven't already, is through your extracurricular commitments, right? You don't need to attain a leadership title in a role in order to demonstrate that you're a strong communicator, that you're a strong organizer, a budgeter, a creator, right? Maybe you're a creative, you're someone who does graphic design for the newspaper. That's a skill set that isn't necessarily, you know, one for one for your major, but something that you'll carry with you. So we encourage you to start reflecting on not just what courses are going to prepare you, what allow you to continue to be successful right now, but what can you carry with you through those soft skills, those employer valued skills that you can then craft in your application and bring with you to college, right? That's going to help us differentiate students who are, you know, investing in themselves in a greater extent, if you will. But we also are college campuses with really exciting communities, right? We don't just want those skills. We want to see people who are actually going to engage in the community. And fundamentally, students who are investing in those capacities aren't just investing in those skills, but also their community engagement as a member.
If I can just jump in with one more thing, I want to emphasize that we are representing but 4 colleges in the entire world. And so we are giving you the absolute best advice that we have. But one of the things you can do in junior year is really start thinking about you know, what kind of school you want to go to? And is it a two-year school? Is it a four-year school? What's the difference between public and private, and why should you care or not? You know, things like distance from home. Are you going to have to get on a plane every time? Does that feel okay to you? Do you want to be close to, you know, those kinds of very, very, very big questions, because that will allow you to narrow it down. And then start doing deeper question and answer sessions, like what Nick was just saying, like, you know, okay, so I'm looking at schools in this area. What did they want to see? What did they think about these soft skills? Are the colleges that I'm applying for not going to require an essay, right? They're just going to require a transcript, or, you know, are they test optional? Does that matter to me? I'm seeing questions in the chat like, you know, will you accept my college credits? And the answer is, it depends, right? You're going to have to ask every college, because we're not just going to have one single answer. So I think during the junior year, as we've said, like alluded to, like honing in kind of on the type of college that you're thinking. Is it going to be, you know, a coalition school? I'm sure we all hope that you apply to coalition schools. Is it going to be a state-based application? You know, all of these are different kinds of things that you'll need to consider. And junior year is a really good time to start thinking about it.
Awesome. Thank you, Sarah. So from what you all have kind of said, it does seem like a lot of things that students kind of have to keep organized. So we already know that we do have the coalition locker where students can kind of keep organized and put files. But do you all have any other advice on ways for students to keep organized, or any tips or advice on that?
Spreadsheet. I do like a spreadsheet. I recommend a spreadsheet, and the name of college are the rows, and then the questions that you want to know all the answers to specifically. You know, and some of them are going to be searchable, and some of them are going to be like you have to actually ask, or like things like location and financial aid policies, test optional policies, etc., so that you can just have like at a glance. Some websites can do that for you, but usually the questions that you really care about, like, can I have a pet in my dorm? Like, those aren't going to be necessarily default questions that you can ask. But I'd say spreadsheet, or if you love the bullet journal, you know, you could do a little bullet journal action. That'd be pretty nice.
Awesome. Thank you for that. So what are some effective ways to research and compare college environments, especially right now, maybe not being able to visit campuses? Do you all have any advice on that? I'll throw that over to Craig.
Yeah, I'll start with this, because I think there has been no better time in like the history of the college search to do what you can do now in terms of assessing a campus, a university, a college, whether academically or culturally and socially. And that's because we've gotten very good at making sure we can put things out there, content out there, virtual content, whether it's through the university itself, through our social media channels, or our student groups and organizations are putting stuff out there and they're getting better at it. In sort of an answer to that last question, I want you all to stay organized, but I also want you all to stay motivated and maybe give yourself a night or two nights or maybe three nights a week where you're specifically picking a different college and doing a little bit of a deep dive. Go on their visit page or their events page, wherever it's located, and watch some of the virtual content that wasn't there 2 years ago. We weren't really good at it then. We're really good at it now. Nobody before you had this type of resources in front of you. So if you don't tap into it, that's where you have a problem. But for all of you on the call tonight, whether you're a counselor or a student, parents, like, you have so much momentum behind you. So just make sure, though, that you are watching it, engaging with it, and not simply ruling a college out or in just based on what you see there. Let that drive some questions, because that's what's going to fuel you when you click that Zoom link to go meet with an admissions counselor or connect with a current student. Now you have some questions and thoughts because you were tuning into the content versus just starting off with, so tell me about your school. You could know about the school and know what question you want to ask now because you are tuning in.
The piece I would also jump in on too is, right, I think we glorify the campus visit experience because it's pretty, it's picturesque. You can take the pictures in front of our university logos with your family. There's a concrete memory there. And we want to first recognize that that isn't something we can necessarily translate right now, hopefully soon, right, for a lot of us. However, it's important to take a step back and be like, why are you actually there? And what is the campus experience actually comprised of? It's comprised of people. And even though we may not be able to talk to you in person, we have teams of admissions officers, current students, and alumni who can give you snapshots as to what their experiences have been like. And those experiences may not be what lights your fire. And that's totally fine. That's half the point. And so we encourage you definitely reach out to an admissions officer if you can't find another contact and ask, can you put me in touch with a current student or an alumni who had this type of experience? Tune into an information session. A lot of universities are advertising student panels, student blogs, and other resources. And so it seems like that's just more content for you to absorb, but we're putting it out there for a very specific purpose because we're trying to put you in front of the people who are living that experience right now. So we know it's virtual, we know things are different. You can still have that emotional response. And we hope that our programming and content can do that for you now.
Thank you, Nick. So we did get a question about what classes should a student take during junior year? And I think I know what the answer is gonna be. But if one of you all can share what the answer is, that'd be great. I'll let Lisa answer it.
Yeah, I was thinking through my mind. I mean, there's so many folks on this session tonight. All of you are likely at different high schools with different curriculum that is recommended, or potentially there are restrictions or just quantity of students per class, that sort of thing. So your best resource is going to be your school counselor, because they're going to be the folks that are looking at the registration, making sure you're on track, and getting you set up for the next year. So as far as advising you on what classes to take, I definitely encourage you to take things that you're interested in. And then, like I think Nick was saying, you want to challenge yourself within the limits of those classes. So if you aren't a super strong French student, but you really enjoy, you know, the art photography class that you have, and then that you can take a higher level class, whatever that might be at your school later on, and you need that art class to take first before you move into the higher level, then that's going to be part of the decision-making process. So we want you to take the rigor where it's available, while still being able to do well in those classes. So keeping your grades up, don't overstretch yourself and just try to sign up for every single class just because it is the most rigorous class that is available to you. We want you to stay sane, and we also want you to enjoy the time that you have in high school, to be able to take advantage of the opportunities outside of the classroom or work a job. So there are plenty of other reasons why you know, your class curriculum shouldn't be the sole focus of what you're doing, and seek your resources. Talk to your school counselors, talk to your family, and see what makes the most sense based off of what you know from the past and then where you're looking ahead for the next year or two.
Awesome. Thank you, Lisa. So now we're going to really get into the college list. So can one of you kind of just tell us what is a college list or a smart college list, and why is having a college list even meaningful?
I can take this one. A college list is, you know, as I think of it, it is a range of colleges with slightly different characteristics that you are going to spend the time and effort and energy to apply to when the time comes. So a college, you know, a smart college list, a good college list is several different schools with all things that you love and that you're excited about, some that are going to be more challenging for you to be admitted to for whatever reason that is. Some are going to be really a perfect kind of match where you think, you know what, I'm just like, you know, the regular old average student that goes here. And then some are going to be more open enrollment, a little bit more of a school that you are pretty sure, right? Like you'd be kind of surprised if you weren't admitted to these schools for whatever reason. And the thing to keep in mind is that literally every student in the country, in the world, has a completely different list. And some schools that for you are going to be incredibly straightforward and simple to be admitted to, and you'd be shocked if you weren't, is going to be somebody else's school where they would be, it's their dream school, right? It's their reach. They would be surprised if they were admitted. So a college list is something that is tailored for you. It is the colleges that you are really going to focus on, make sure that you have all the application pieces for, know all the financial aid deadlines for, all the, you know, special program deadlines for, and those are going to be your set, your key into the next 4 years or however long of your life.
Awesome, thank you. So the next question that was submitted a lot of times was actually, what are reach, match, and safety or likely schools, and how many of each should you have on your list? So I know that's a really loaded question as well. So you know what, I think I'm gonna ask Nick to answer it.
Great, thank you. Set myself up earlier, so now I'm gonna get the hard ones, right? So I think Sarah really started to allude to these definitions, and so I'm going to build off of her answer definitely. Reach schools are the schools in the category that you know are going to be a reach, right? You're stretching for them. They're a little bit harder for you to be admitted to for whatever reason, right? As Sarah said, it could be because they get tens of thousands of applications for only a certain number of spots. Maybe it's because they have impacted majors, meaning they only take a certain number of spots for particular programs at their school, right? There's a lot of reasons why some schools may be more or less selective. Typically, it has to do with application numbers. And are you going to be the student who stands out in that pool that university gets? In general, right, you should have a few reach options if that's appropriate for you, because they're reaches. And so putting your faith in one reach is statistically improbable, right? So you do want to make sure you distribute it across your list. Target schools are the ones that Sarah was describing, are you meet the quantitative benchmarks for that institution, the published GPA averages, or the middle 50 percentiles for SAT or ACT or other sort of standardized metrics that they may ask for. If they're test optional, there's going to be some other ways that you can identify academic match with the school. But for the most part, these are schools that you can say, I'm going to be confident that I can get in here. It would be, you know, it's not a given, it's not a promise, but this is a school that you should feel confident you can be admitted into. Safeties are schools where you should feel really confident that you can get into these schools, right? Some great examples. So I'm originally from Massachusetts, right? In Massachusetts, state schools have scholarships for students who get a certain percentile on state examinations that you can use at those state schools, right? If you get that scholarship, that's a pretty good indication that you will likely be admitted to that institution, right? And so it's thinking through scenarios of, are the schools going to be the best ones for you? Are they the ones in your backyard? What are the acceptance rates or admissions rates? Are they going to be the financial fits, right? Safety isn't just about admission. It's about how much you're willing to expend financially for the educational experience you wish to have. And so it's building this list of selectivity, but also match and comfort. Now, the tricky part to this question as well is, or that easily follows it, is how many should be on that list? And that's a really tricky question because your family, your financial circumstances, what you're willing to apply to are going to be up to you. I think the national average of applications to college is 8. I don't want to be misquoted, but I believe it's 8. So if you think of that range, right, and you want to equally distribute them, you're probably going to have 2 or 3 in each of those categories, right? And so you should think of a balanced list. You shouldn't have 7 of your 8 be incredibly highly selective reach institutions with 1 target school and no safeties, right? What happens if you get into none of them, which is a statistical possibility, right? And so we really want you to think through, how can you set yourself up for success? Circling all the way back to the beginning, though, of what Sarah was talking about, all of those schools on that list, you should care about and recognize that you're going to be happy at those institutions, right? It's not an order of operations of, this is my happiest school and this is my least happy school. These are all schools that you can envision yourself at because they're the right school for you. They're going to serve you in your interests, but you're thinking and playing the game strategically.
Thank you, Nick. So this question I think can maybe go to all of you all, but a couple of students submitted this question. I think it might be in the Q&A as well. Students are wondering, how can they find a target or a likely or a safety or a reach school in absence of SAT scores? So I think you touched on that briefly, Nick, but just wanted to have other admissions counselors weigh in as well.
I know for us, the GPA and last year's previous test scores are still available for students to see as far as what our middle 50% are. And I think for any student junior and below, you've likely taken or will take some examination. So if you maybe took a PSAT a long time ago, you have some general idea of where you scored potentially, and then can sort of mirror that to what you think you would score if you were to take the test again, or if you were to take a practice test online just to see where you might fall. But I know that there's so much more to the application process than the test scores. So I think in looking at the target, you know, I think every other institution, academics was truly the main focus for what we reviewed primarily. And so keeping your focus on your grades and how well you're doing in your classes is the best thing that you can do at this moment, but know sort of those ranges that are out there that colleges have provided. And some of my other colleagues might have other information that is published that students can look at for best match.
A lot of high schools also have resources in-house, like Naviance, like SCORE, and that will be unique for your school. Sometimes they'll have little graphs. Also, like, talk to your counselor. I know some of them are very busy and it's really challenging, you know, but if you're a part of like a community organization as well, if you're given somebody there, ask, like, what kind of schools do you see me looking at? But I really want to highlight something that Nick said as well, is that, you know, when you're looking at colleges where the acceptance rate is in the single digits, right, 4% acceptance rate, 8% acceptance rate, that can't be the entire list, nor should it be for probably most students applying to college. So you really want to have a balanced list. And again, talking to your counselors, using the resources, you know, is it in state or out of state? How many applications do they get a year is a huge question. And you can't predict that. You can't control that, right? But if they're getting 40,000 applications a year and your GPA is a 2.0, you're out of state, and, you know, you're kind of an average high school student, it's likely that that is not going to be a safety school for you, where it may be for somebody else that you know, somebody that's your friend. So talk with the resources that you have, talk with teachers, talk with family members or people that you know that are in college. You can learn a lot of things from books and internet, but you can also learn a lot just by talking to the folks that you have access to.
A couple other metrics just off the top of my head. The percentile of the class that most schools admit from, right? Are they admitting mostly students in the top 10% of high schools, or are they going pretty deep into the class? If you're an international student or plan on taking the English language proficiency exam, those minimum thresholds are oftentimes very different. The most selective institutions oftentimes do not have ESL or, you know, English learner, English 101 type programs when you arrive. And so that could be an indicator that this is a better match for you. Subject test scores, also AP scores, IB scores, those are all helpful barometers that are also metrics, quantitative pieces that you can find on websites or ask admissions officers about if that will help ground that definition for you.
And then lastly, because I think this is a lot of advice on a difficult subject matter, I think one thing maybe somewhat hidden in this, and Nick kind of mentioned a number, it's not a number you all have to have, but if you're not going overboard on your college list, like applying to way too many schools, these conversations are a lot easier, especially the nuanced conversations, especially if you're applying to a particular part of a college, right? Maybe the business program, the nursing program. Now, all of a sudden, something that might be in a target school could become a little bit more of a reach. And you want to make sure you have enough time and enough opportunity to reach out to the schools. We'll be able to give you our middle averages of our GPAs, but we might not have all the other info. But when you're having that conversation, you can get a sense of, oh, wait, this might be a really good fit for me, and I might be a target student for this particular program. And that will happen with a nice balanced and not too crazy of a list.
Thanks, Craig. So if a student thinks that finances or financial aid is going to be very important to them, how would that affect their college list or their college search? And I'm going to just throw it out to anyone.
One of the pieces of advice I will give is that if you think it's important, if you're sure it's important, regardless, this is the time to have a very serious, very grown-up conversation with your adults at home, whoever they may be, whoever you may be thinking is going to contribute to college or has told you in the past that they will. Now's the time to really sit down, maybe not now like tonight, but as you get through this process, really have an open and honest conversation about what these grown-ups are expecting to pay. Are they expecting that you have absolutely no loans whatsoever, period? Okay, all right, that's fine. That's, you know, a belief. Is it that you will be in-state? Is it that they will only pay for the in-state tuition? And if you go above that, you're on your own. What kinds of loans can you qualify for or not qualify for? I've had several instances where students were kind of exposed to some very important family information that they were not previously privy to as a part of this process. Like, we will not qualify for certain types of financial aid, or, you know, a parent had lost their job and not told their son or daughter because they just didn't. So it's hard. It's a hard conversation. But if finances are going to be important to you, you want to know that the questions that you ask are reasonable, right? So if you think rich Uncle Joey is just going to be paying tuition, and you're like, ah, I'm not going to ask any questions, this is fine, and then you realize that rich Uncle Joey is not paying for anything, you're not asking the right questions. If you know that your parents say that you cannot have any loans, or that, you know, you are only hoping to pay a certain amount, then that's where you can start that conversation with the colleges. We all have something called the net price calculator. Net price calculator, take your notes. We're all required to have it. And so whoever, again, is a grown-up at home or a grown-up that will be involved in this process with you can go in, settle down, get their information in front of them, and get a sense of what colleges are going to expect them to pay. Pretty much every person at every one of our colleges pays something. Even if it's $500, they probably pay something to go there. And so you would want to know what that number may or may not be. And that number will change for each college. So I'll let everybody else kind of chime in if they wish.
The net price calculator is a great tool that is consistent across campuses. The other resource that you can look at now is the FAFSA forecaster. So the free application for federal student aid can predict what your expected family contribution and or just the total amount that colleges might expect your family to pay for college. If that number is zero, that means that we don't expect your family to pay anything. Now, how each of our institutions use that number is going to be different, but it can give you a general sense of the grants that you might be eligible for when you do become a senior. So there's nothing you actually need to apply for now as an underclassman, but you can start getting these numbers and know that they're not set in stone. Know that there are many merit scholarships. There are other grants dependent on the state. There are many different scenarios that could play out. Just be cautious that you're not going into this thinking, I'm going to have every college paid for. I'm not going to have to do anything else. So I know Sarah just said that you may have a little bit of skin in the game. And I think many institutions want some sort of contribution from the student, even if it is student employment while they're working on campus, just because it is part of your sort of investment into your own education as well.
I want to just have everybody also keep the bigger picture in mind. And I think it's important that we're also having this conversation with Coalition, which you already have a pre-filtered list of schools that have cost of college, but also the other factors that affect cost already built in. What I mean by this is finding a school that's affordable is certainly one of these factors. And for many of you, you might be going on to graduate school. So finding an undergraduate program that's exceptionally affordable is usually a big factor. But also, what's the graduation rate like, right? If you're graduating that school in 6, 7, 8 years, even if the cost is not that much upfront, that adds up. What's the success rate like? Meaning the students who graduate, are they paying off their loans if they took out even small amounts of loans? Are they still able to pay that off? Meaning, are they getting jobs that help them pay that off? And other things about like making sure you fit in a school is also an important factor. Because if you don't really find that fit and the school's not really giving you that, even that cultural vibe that you're looking for, the right setting, academic support, it becomes even trickier to navigate those waters, no matter what the cost is, in the long run. So just try to make sure you're factoring all these pieces when you talk about cost of college, not just the overall sticker price.
All right, thank you so much, Craig. That actually goes really well into the next question. So students were asking, what are some factors that they should be considering? Because we talk about college fit. So one student was asking, are there any must or must nots that they should consider when creating a college list and thinking about their college search?
Sure, I can start with that. There's the stuff right out the gate that you need to be considering. The classroom environment. What classroom environment are you going to be most successful in? Are you okay with a larger lecture? Are you someone who can digest information, maybe rewatch the lecture, read your textbook in order to learn? Or are you more of a Socratic seminar type of student, right? Someone who wants to be in a smaller classroom with a discussion. And the point of the discussion is that you're learning from each other. You're learning and sharing ideas together, and the professor is kind of pushing you along in a certain direction, right? That's a very different style. It's one that's very common in the liberal arts classroom. And so it's important for you to figure out what classroom can you learn in. Right now, we know that there's only so many types of classroom environments that you've had an opportunity to experience, right? For the most part, in your high school, you have the curriculum set by your school, and your teachers probably curate a classroom environment that's pretty similar from class to class, right? You may have the English teacher who loves the Socratic seminar where you're sitting on pillows on the floor, and maybe you have that. Every school has that English teacher, right? We all love them. But we also recognize you don't have the full breadth of these experiences. And so it's important for you to think, okay, what does my ideal classroom environment look like? And how can I figure that out, right? What classes can I take in high school? What notes can I look up online? What, excuse me, what other pieces can I figure out for the classroom environment? Second, match an identity. And so there's, you know, a community element to the college campus that you need to see yourself in. There's a lot of different organizations at all of our schools. There's probably a lot of similar organizations at a lot of our schools, but that doesn't mean that they function or act the same way. And so it's important for you to figure out what organizations you would like to continue investing in, what communities, whether that's your religious community, your LGBTQ community, your racial or ethnic community, what have you. Does an organization have an avenue for you to explore that or continue exploring that if that's something that's important to you, right? And so it's the classroom environment. What classes are there? How are those classes structured? And are those the experiences you wish to have? The extracurricular match pieces in terms of community and how you can imagine yourself growing as a person. Access to faculty and career resources, I would say, is the third major category. This is all to achieve an end goal. And so match here isn't just how well you're going to be here for 4 years, but also how well you'll be for the rest of your life. And so what are the career resources, outcomes, and statistics that help drive those decisions? And so I would say those are the three big categories that I recommend to start with.
This is another thing where it's going to be so dependent on you and what you care about and what's important to you. Some of the things that I really cared about was that I never wanted to take gym class again. Hate gym class. So I was like, what colleges do I not have to take a gym class in? For some of you, you're like, I want to be a gym teacher, and I am offended that you said that. Well, okay, cool. We're going to be looking at different schools. So it's kind of a silly example. It is real, but the must and must nots are going to be so, so personal, that yes, can you have them? Absolutely. Should you have some? Yeah, absolutely, probably. But, you know, are they all going to be the same? No way, nor should they be.
Awesome. So we had mentioned a little bit about the campus environment. There were a couple of questions that were thrown out about how to find a college that supports first-generation students, and also how to find colleges that support students who might need some learning support services. Can you all address how to find colleges?
I think for the first generation question, you can use your Google or search engine to type in the university and then first generation after it to see what websites might be out there that the university has support services listed. That's a good way to see, you know, the investment or time that they're spending on first generation students, or maybe even just the percentage of first generation students at the institution, so that you know what is out there. I think support is offered across the spectrum of colleges and unique to the student situation. So if there is something that you're looking for in particular, we'd love to connect you with those offices so that we can really get specific questions answered, because there's not a one size fits all when it comes to support.
Thank you.
I was going to say, this is one of those other areas, if you're tuning into a lot of presentations and going to these events, colleges that definitely have the support resources, if they have a lot of students who are first generation college students, they're going to be sure to tell you. So this is where you got to keep your ears open and show up, especially to these virtual events, because you're going to start to see this all add up in the direction of the right fit school.
Awesome. So there was another question too about how to find a school that's a financial fit. And I know we've talked a little bit about the FAFSA and EFC and net price calculators. Any other tips that you have for students in finding a school that's going to be not just an academic or social fit, but also a financial fit?
Some institutions do have the equivalent of an admissions officer, a financial aid officer, who is forward facing for prospective students and families. I do not want to say that that's a norm, or that you will find that at every institution, but that is a potential resource depending on the school that you ask. And so they're willing to counsel you in financial aid preparation, not just for that school, but just financial aid information generally. There's a lot of federal loans that you can take advantage of. There's a lot of monthly payment plans, or just general payment plans, that you can build into your financial commitments. But all of these schools are going to have different things. So step one, research the school and reach out to an admissions officer or financial aid officer at that institution with your specific financial aid questions. Then, like we said at the beginning, type away and put that in that big spreadsheet that you're making, right? That will help you distill down the differences between the financial aid options there. But match is really going to be a very personal thing financially. You know, to use a more business type term, what's the risk tolerance you're willing to make, right? You have to lay that along your college list, right? How much are you willing to pay for your reach schools, your favorite schools, your dream schools, your target schools, and your safeties? And so it's a rather complicated question, but it's ultimately one that if you feel comfortable with that number, then it sounds like you're reaching your match, right? But that will be very independent.
Awesome, thank you. So going back to building a smart college list, there were a couple of questions that I think are in the Q&A, but also that were submitted. Students saying, what if I have no idea what I want to study? I have no idea what I want to be. How can I find a college that's a good fit for me? I'll let Lisa answer that first.
Oh, man. So there are quite a few inventories that you can take online to at least send you in a direction. So is it art and science that you're interested in? Great. In many cases, students have a lot of interest, and that's what makes it hard to narrow down to one thing. All of us likely have a career center as part of our campus as well that is there to help students figure out that path as well by taking inventories. There are a couple other things that schools utilize, other platforms. I'm trying to think of the one that we use at our school, where students could take an inventory of aptitude tests to then discover what they're naturally good at, and then also what they're interested in and where those two things align, because it's great if you want to be something, but at the end of the day, the tasks that you'll be doing within that job don't align with what you like. So going in undeclared, I know we mentioned it at the beginning, is actually a really great opportunity for students to then discover something as part of the general curriculum that students will take. And it is not uncommon. So I think as you're asking colleges, if it's in the top five majors, then you're probably in safe territory where students are okay to come in not knowing what they want to do, but maybe having a direction or maybe having discovered something about themselves that they want to explore a little bit further in their first year. And know that changing your major can be scary, even if you come in with a major declared, but we have lots of folks on campus and advisors to help walk you through that. So don't feel like you have to do it alone. Ask your family members, ask your school counselor, but also ask the colleges once you're there, if you find yourself navigating towards a different direction, because we want to make sure we can help make you graduate on time and then also successful in those classes that you're taking with whatever major it is that you end up exploring.
All right, thank you, Lisa. So I have one more question, I think, for all of you all, and then we might be out of time. But Sarah, one question that a lot of the students had as they're sophomores and juniors and heading into the summer is, what should they do during the summer? Should they volunteer? Should they work? Should they seek a summer program? Any advice on that?
An excellent question. There are, you know, several folks in the chat like, well, I'm a part of this. Is that enough? What's the best? And the answer is there's no right answer. There is nothing that you can do short of like literally being probably the president of the United States that we're going to be like, admit based on that. It's pretty unlikely. And even then. So I think ultimately what you do over the summer is going to be a great way for you to explore some things. You know, maybe if you're considering some academic areas, like Lisa was just saying, you know, if you've taken some things, some quizzes, or talked to some folks and thought, oh, well, maybe I'm interested in this certain area, maybe do a summer program or something, you know, some sort of work aligned with that area and see if you do like it. Some of you are involved in scouting or other kinds of community organizations, do that. Over the summer, if you wish to take classes, you can take classes. Like we'll come back to the engineering and business or the engineering and math example, where, you know, if you know that you're not going to get to calculus, but it's going to make you look really competitive, maybe you take an additional math class over the summer. Summers are also time for you to be a real human teenager and spend time with friends. You know, hopefully we're in a place this summer where we can do things like that again, and, you know, watch movies and complain on the internet and, you know, watch TikToks. Lehigh admissions has a TikTok, so you should follow us on TikTok. But anyway, those kinds of things are okay too, right? So it doesn't need to be this jam-packed summer where all you do is college research and summer programs that you think are going to get you admitted to a college, which are really just for you to explore things. If you want to work. If you need to work, it's okay to work. The thing that we want to know, though, and the thing that will impact your application is, what did you do with the time? How did you choose to use your time? And how have you grown because of it? Do you have a leadership role, right? If you started out as a Cub Scout and now you're an Eagle Scout, Order of the Arrow, you know, Girl Scout Gold Award, Silver Award winner, fantastic. But tell us about that. That is not inherently better or worse than you being captain of debate, drum major of the band, captain of the lacrosse team, or anything else. We like to see how you've grown over time, what you've chosen to do with your time. If you have all sports, fabulous, colleges will admit you. If you have no sports, fabulous, colleges will admit you. It's just what makes you a person and how you will be on our campus, what you will pursue or not pursue. So over the summer is a great opportunity for you to pursue the things that you like doing, or that you think you will learn more about yourself by doing, and doing a summer course and saying, okay, I'm going to do a pre-med summer thing, and then realizing, nope, don't like it, don't want to be pre-med. Well, then that's made your college search a little bit easier, because you're going to be looking at it at a different, perhaps, set of majors and programs.
Awesome. Thank you, Sarah. So Nick, one question that I've been seeing in the Q&A as well as were submitted, are there any additional factors that homeschool students should consider in this entire process of building a college list?
Additional factors for homeschool students. I think the most obvious answer to the, or the most obvious part of that question is the community piece, because your homeschool environment may look very different, whether it's an online environment, right? There was a lot of online environment schools prior to COVID-19 and the migration into the virtual learning space. But if you yourself are at home doing independent learning with a family member or a sibling or what have you, the community element is going to look very different, right? If you haven't taken college classes or spent time on a college campus or at a traditional high school experience, maybe you're a military kid and you've shuffled around, and so this is the best experience for you. And so your community looks very different. All I'm trying to say is the community piece is probably going to be the factor you need to leverage the most, because it will be the biggest shift away from the current experience that you hold. However, the other piece is academic, because not all homeschool curriculums are created, or curricula are created equally. Right, there are some that are driven by standard AP or college courses or an IB diploma even, but we do want you to think very strategically about whether your homeschool curriculum created by a parent or a relative who isn't an educator or something like that, what will that offer you in the long term, in terms of what the school will need in order to understand that you're going to be competitive for that school. The most emotional piece is going to be that community piece, but I don't want to divorce that from the conversation of what is that homeschool curriculum going to prepare you for.
Awesome, thank you, Nick. And then the last question for Craig, if a student feels like they're just an average student, what kind of recommendations or suggestions do you have for them as they think about building a smart college list?
Yeah, and I get this question all the time. And one thing I will say, your goal is not to change who you are, but is also to find schools that sort of meet you at where you're at. Meaning you are going to be looking at schools. You do want to make sure that whatever moment you're in, that you do dial in on your academics. So if you're saying you're average now, it doesn't mean you're going to be average for life. There's always time academically to try to find your sweet spot. And you should always be working towards that. But in addition to all that, we want to know who you are as a student. Your essay that you're going to put together, and maybe even your supplemental essays that some colleges may look at, is going to tell us more about you. If you think you're average, explain what that means to you. You're showing your awareness about who you are in this world. That is something a college wants to see. The things you're doing outside the classroom, they may seem average to you, but they may not be average to somebody else. They may not be average to the admissions team. So don't be afraid of who you are, is where I'm going with this. As long as you're doing something, you're putting yourself out there. Even if right now you don't feel comfortable going out of your way doing something, read 10 books, get some ideas going. Put that on your extracurricular piece. That's something different, right? There's so many ways to look at this from a different lens. And keep in mind, that's what we're doing. We're looking for those of you who might think you're average to fit our campuses as best as we can see you fitting us.
Okay, well, thank you so much. I know we are just over time. I just wanted to give one opportunity for any of you all to give any last piece of advice for students as they're starting to go into summer and creating these lists. So any 10 second, 15 second piece of advice you want to throw out, feel free.
I'm going to just echo something I said earlier. Keep tuning in, right? If you're not doing it, go to more coalition events and go to college specific events. You have to do it because other students are doing it and you want to make sure you got that knowledge too.
Yeah, don't overthink the process. There are a lot of people in your corner ready to help. So including all of us on this call, there are friendly folks at all of the campuses who are just ready and waiting to answer your questions. So don't be afraid to reach out. We're here to help.
Think of your application as a time capsule of this moment in life for you right now. I know there's a lot of pressure. I know these conversations and the looming threat of applying to universities can feel really intense, but there is a fondness in looking back on this application process and seeing who you were at this moment in time. And if you approach this process with that authenticity, recognizing that you're creating a time capsule that you can reflect back on and be like, wow, look at what I achieved at that moment in time and how that's going to set me up for the future. It will change your mindset about this process and hopefully create it a little bit more introspective one, one that's also more inherently healthy for you to process as well.
And hopefully also a healthy perspective is that this is really kicking off the time in your life where you start making the decisions and other people aren't making them for you. And so I hope that that's exciting for you, and you get to choose the classes that you take in college, and you get to choose the clubs that you're a part of, and you get to choose who you're friends with and who you have access to, and all of the wonderful things that come along with being a little bit more independent than you likely are now. Parents right now are absolutely freaking out, but it's true. And so ideally, this is a great opportunity for you to really kind of grow into who you are, have some quiet moments with yourself, and really become somebody that you're proud of, because I'm sure you all will.
Sarah, Lisa, Nick, Craig, thank you all so much for joining us tonight and for sharing your words of wisdom with everyone in attendance. Also, thank you to the students, the parents, guardians, and counselors, advisors who took the time out tonight as well. As Craig said, keep on tuning in. We do have some Coalition virtual fairs that are coming up, and you can access the link in the chat and sign up for those. So thank you, everyone, and have a really great night. See ya.